Redwood family. It's a joy to join you on this Thursday evening Bible study and our ministry in the Word in the middle of the week. And my prayer is that God has been using this series in your life to really just broaden your understanding of the big picture. And we have been in this now for over 6 months and learning about just God's big, grand redemptive plan and why redemption was needed because of sin, and then what it meant to be a Christian, all of the beautiful gifts that we got in Christ, all of the power that we got in Christ. But then we also looked into now the battlefield that we're in. And so if you're just now picking up this series and you have missed several weeks, I would encourage you to go back to our YouTube channel, We Are Redwood, and begin to kind of pick up on this. This is a building story over the course of these many, many months. And what makes this third leg of the journey of this future where we don't always understand everything that's going on, and where I haven't understood, I have let you know that this is simply just my belief. But understanding where we came from really does shed light on to where we're headed. And we spent last week beginning just this idea of looking at the judgment seat of Christ as well as the great white throne judgment and the separation that Jesus Christ will be a part of. He's going to gather all of us, and then there's going to be a separation of, you know, true believers and then those that are not believers. And so tonight, I want to move this peg just a little bit further and kind of look further into the actual judgment seat itself. And I've entitled our message time this evening, The Evidence Used at the Judgment. And there are many things about this final judgment that God has not told us and that we do not fully understand. It's difficult to kind of ponder how will God be able to bring perfect justice to literally billions and billions of people that have lived through the course of time. How will he bear that out? And what are some encouragement that we can take from it? That's really my goal tonight, is to definitely shed some light on what will be judged, but at the end of the day, for us to understand that God is just and that he will bring things to light, so that will allow us, as we go through life, to really rest in that knowledge. And so last week, we began to learn that there will be a judgment and nobody will avoid it. We saw in 2 Corinthians 5:10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. All of it's going to get thrown into a fire, and there's going to be wood, hay, and stubble, or gold, silver, and precious stones. And that's for the believer. That's for the individual that has trusted Christ as their Savior. But if that's not been your case, or you know someone that hasn't trusted him as your Savior, let me read about their judgment again tonight. And that's found in Revelation 20, verse number 11. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Let me just say here really quickly, there are religious systems in our world that are completely built, and its foundation is on works. It is on things that we do, or maybe things that we don't do. And it is very man-centered. When you read about this judgment seat, this great white throne judgment in Revelation 20, John, who has seen this vision of it coming to place, He says on two different occasions that they will be judged by their works. And so, my friends, we do not want to be judged at the end of this life based on our works. They will all fall short. All of our righteousnesses, all of our even good deeds, they're literally as filthy rags compared to the righteousness of God. And so we want to cling to the very righteousness of Jesus Christ. And so there are these judgments that are before us in Scripture, and there's going to be this separation, and it's throughout Scripture. We saw in Romans 14:10, but why dost thou judge thy brother? And why dost thou set it not thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. The believers will. So then every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. And then we said in Hebrews 4, verse 13, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, speaking of God's sight. But all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. So as I said last week, in other words, we're going to all give an account before God. There's going to be no spinning of the truth. There's going to be no hiding from it. It is all laid out before him. And so either we're going to have to give an account for everything that we have done, or we're going to cling to Jesus Christ, who will have stood in our place and who will have taken on our account, our sin. Sinless himself, but taken on our sin so that we might be able to live in his righteousness. And we learned last week about who the judge will be. The judge will be Jesus Christ. And that's a beautiful truth. Friends, this is of huge importance because, as I said last week, we know who the judge will be. And this is such amazing information to be given because this judge, as we learned last week, he offers himself as your substitute. He offers himself as your savior and your advocate. And so not only will he be judging you, but he also can be standing next to you as your friend. This is grace. This is mercy that the very judge would invite you to be his friend. But I want us to pull some layers back here tonight, and I want us to begin to think about the evidence that's going to be used at this judgment. Well, I want you to notice, first of all, our works. I know I alluded to that earlier in Revelation chapter number 20, but our works, it's what we do is going to be judged. In Revelation 22, verse 12, I like what this says. It says, and behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his work shall be. And so this is a reward for the believer. And so our works do, they come into play. It's not for salvation, but it's for ultimately a reward that we will place back at Jesus' feet. Matthew 16, verse 27 says, for the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then shall he reward every man according to his works. We saw in 2 Corinthians 5:10 already, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every man receive that thing done in his body according to that what he had done, whether it be good or bad. So salvation is through faith, because faith invites us to a union with Christ, and he saves us. But judgment is focused on works for the evil that will be punished and for the good that will be rewarded. So for the believer, these works will yield reward, but for the lost person, it's going to yield to punishment. And so that's why Jesus Christ says that literally for the Christian, you give a cup of cold water in my name, it's going to be remembered. It's going to even be rewarded. So for a person in Christ, this is a reason for great encouragement to live a life that honors and glorifies God, to do it for him. Why? Because it's all going to be seen. It's all going to be remembered. It's all going to be rewarded. You don't know Christ, it's all going to be remembered and then punished for those works. 1 Corinthians 3:8 says, now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. And so allow this to be an encouragement. In the perfect justice of God, there is going to be a sentencing for those who are outside of Christ and rewards for those who are in Christ. So works, they're going to be used as evidence at these judgments, but also our words. Matthew 12, verse 36 says, "But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned." And so, as I said last week, that is why James says that teachers of the word, teachers of Jesus, they will be under, you know, greater strictness. We are responsible for what we teach others. If we speak in Christ's name, we're going to give an account to Christ of what we said about and in his name. So if I was simply in ministry or a preacher of the gospel for my comfort, listen, we would never have a series like this. And I'd have to give an account for that. And you would rightly ask me, "Pastor, how come I never learned about these hard truths?" I'll be honest with you, this series hasn't been even the easiest to study. I mean, I love preaching Christ. I love preaching the realities of Christ in our life, but it's not always been easy speaking about our depravity and what we really are apart from Christ. And so that's why those that use this office, this teaching of the Word of God, were held to a higher standard. And I pray that you always desire, my friends, a church where they preach the whole counsel of God, that they don't shy away from tough and difficult just stances and verses and texts. And so there's some times where I don't fully understand what it says, and I humbly admit that before you. So our works, they're going to be used as evidence. Our words, but the Bible also says our motives. In 1 Corinthians 4, verse 5, "Therefore judge nothing before the time, until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts, and then shall every man have praise of God." See, the motives of other people, they're hidden from us. And so that is why we must be very careful about making judgments about the motives of other people. See, it's a terrible thing to ascribe evil motives to someone. It is something you would have to give an account for. You're going to have to give an answer for that at some point. But Paul says that we must not pronounce judgment on motives before the time. The reason why is because the day is coming when the Lord, he will let all this out. He will judge the motives. So we can relax, not look at another person and begin to judge them and be like, "Ah, well, you're just in it for the money," or whatever that is. We can treat people at face value. We can love them. We don't have to try to read between the lines. We don't have to do any of that. Why? Because God is seeing all of that. And he will, when the time comes, display those motives as evidence for the judgment. Not only our motives, but also our secrets. Romans 2, verse 16 says, "In the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ, according to my gospel." Ecclesiastes, Solomon says, "For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil." Luke 12, 2 says, "For there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, neither hid that shall not be known. Therefore, whatsoever ye have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light, and that which ye have spoken in the ear in closets shall be proclaimed upon the housetops." Now, this evidence that's going to be on display, our works, our words, our motives, our secrets, to someone who's not trusted Jesus Christ as our Savior, that is terrifying, because God, he sees it all. God, he hears it all. God literally can penetrate the very heart and motive and the things that we hide from others. He can see it on full display. So allow that, if you do not know Christ as your Savior, to terrify you. Because as we learned last week, the judge is going to separate. And there's going to be a casting into hell that we'll learn about here in a few weeks. But listen, Jesus Christ can also become your friend. Jesus Christ can also become your advocate. Jesus Christ can also take on all of those nasty deeds and those words and the wrong motives. And he can take all of that upon himself when he died some 2,000 years ago. And his perfect record can be applied to you. Because the Christian can hear that our works will be on display, our words will be on display, our motives will be on display, our secrets will be on display, and we know that there's no more condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. So those sins, completely under the blood, that's not what's going to be brought up at our judgment. It's going to be our good works. It's going to be our good words. It's going to be our good motives and the things that we've done for God. And those will yield reward if they've been done in the right fashion. So I want to encourage you, how do you prepare for this judgment? Well, obviously it starts with accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior. And if you've not, go to our website, wearedwood.org. Click on the link that says eternity and make tonight the night where Jesus Christ becomes not only your judge, but he becomes your advocate. So obviously that's where you start. You trust Jesus Christ as your Savior. But can I also tell you that there's some practical ways to live your life based on the truth in which we're learning? And that is that God is going to bring to light perfect justice. Nothing is hidden from him. Not a single deed is done that he doesn't see. Not a word is spoken that is not heard by him. Not a motive or even a secret thing is not fully open before God. And so perfect justice is going to be brought. And so what practically can that do for your everyday life? Well, we can be patient in this life, and we can try to do the very best to live at peace in this life. Paul tells us in Romans 12, verse 18, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. I love that verse because it's not always possible. And Paul is not requiring the other person to do this. He's saying everything that liveth within you, if it's possible for you to do it, to live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. So the fact of what we've been learning last week and definitely this week of what type of evidence is going to be used at this judgment is that once all of this is understood, we can pursue a life of peace because we know that God ultimately is going to bring about justice. And so when you know that Jesus Christ is the judge and you know that one day he will bring things into the light, hear me, you can choose to trust an unsolved grievance or injustice into the hands of God. You're able to know that I might not see justice in this life. There's been something egregious done unto me, but I can take that because I know that all of it is before God, and I can place that into the hands of God. Thomas Watson, in his book, A Body of Divinity, says this: what a comfort it is to the saints who were met with unrighteous judgment in this world, who have been wronged of their estates in lawsuits, or have had their lives taken away by an unrighteous sentence. Christ will judge things over again and will give a righteous sentence. So when we fully understand the full picture of this, we can take our grievances, whether there was justice met or not in this life, and we're free to live peaceably because we can hand those over to the one that can take care of it. What else does this truth, what can it do for us? Well, there are situations in which you cannot get to the truth, and you are left wondering what really happened. Let's just be real. That's going to happen in this life. Mysteries, that are never resolved in this life will be unraveled before the throne of God. Someday we will know. Thomas Boston, in The Human Nature in its Fourfold State, says this: secret murders, adulteries, thefts, cheats, and other works of darkness which defied all human search will be discovered and laid open before the world with their most minute circumstances. Thomas Watson goes on to say, he is so wise that he cannot be deluded, and so strong that he cannot be resisted. So a person who has managed to shield the truth maybe from you or someone else will never be able to shield that truth from God. You will live with this unresolved now because you can know that God is going to someday bring it to light. It literally allows you to move forward, understanding the judgment, understanding perfect justice in God can let you move forward. One other area of just practical implication with the truths here tonight is knowing that God will bring the truth to light will help you bear the burden of unfair criticism. See, there will be times in your life when people will misjudge you. There will be times when they will assign evil motives to you, and they will say all manner against you. How do you handle that? Well, tonight actually should give you the fuel to be able to attempt to live peaceably with all men. Because Paul talked about this. Paul was being criticized on all different fronts. He was being criticized for who he was, as his nationality, all the different just areas. He was being heavily criticized. And Paul said to the church at Corinth in 1 Corinthians 4, "But with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged of you, or of man's judgment. Yea, I judge not mine own self, for I know nothing by myself, yet am I not hereby justified, but he that judgeth me is the Lord." So in this barrage of criticism that is coming the Apostle Paul's way, he says, God knows my heart. And he says in that text later, my conscience is clear. So when the Lord comes, he will bring the truth to light. The great truth of the final judgment saves him from being crippled by these false judgments that were coming Paul's way. I believe we need this truth. It can help us to move forward in our life. We are going to be lied about. We are going to have things that are twisted. And listen, we are freed from having to bear that grudge on our own. Instead, we literally can live our lives as before God. I was right in this situation. Now listen, if we weren't right before God and we weren't right in a situation, I would implore you to make it right. I'm not talking about covering up sin, but where you were maybe maligned or misjudged, the ultimate justice that God will bring allows you to live in freedom today because future justice is coming. So can I encourage you once again with the hope of befriending Jesus Christ now. Make him your Savior now. The gospel is this beautiful truth that your judge, who is Jesus Christ, is also your Savior if you've accepted him. He's also your friend. And I want to leave you one last time with Thomas Boston. He writes to the Christian believer in The Human Nature in its Fourfold State. I mentioned this last week, and I'm going to leave you with this one more time. Let not the terror of that day dispirit you when you think upon it. When you think about this whole last day judgment as a Christian, don't let it bother you. He says, lift up your heads with joy, for the last day will be your best day. The judge is your head and husband, your redeemer and your advocate. You must appear before the judgment seat, he says, but you shall not come into condemnation, nor do you stand there alone. And so, church family, as we continue to move through these future events, allow tonight's message to actually be fuel for living as much as possible, peaceable life. Knowing that God is going to see every work, every word, every idle thought, every motive, every secret, that he sees it all, and with perfect justice, it's going to be meted out, then you can release people from what they've done. Because ultimately, God is going to judge them. Now, our prayer is that all of us would actually stand in the righteousness of God. A few weeks from now, we're going to learn about hell, and we would not wish hell on anybody, not even our greatest enemy. And so, justice will be served. My friends, it might be an eternity in hell for those people, and we pray that that's not the case. Or that justice was, hear me, was fully met some 2,000 years ago when all of the full wrath that was needed for justice to be met was placed on Jesus. And we get rescued in our relationship with him. So as I said last week, believer, pillow your head tonight on a soft, soft pillow, because Jesus indeed is enough. I want you to know that I've been praying for you, and I'm thankful that you allow me to bring the Word of God to you on a weekly basis. I'm also thankful for Pastor Mike. I'm thankful for his ministry as he has transitioned, of course, into his business of filming and photography and video, but as just a person that just loves our church, loves you all, he is continually giving of his time so that we can bring this ministry to you. So I'm thankful for him. He's on the other side of this camera right now, but the next time you see him, make sure that you thank him for all that he does. God bless you.